Welcome to Halting Towards Zion, the podcast where we limp like Jacob to the promised land and talk about life, the universe, and everything along the way. I'm Emily Maxson, here with Greg Ettinger and Rachel Wojtek. And as promised, we are starting from, well, as beginning gets, I think, with the Greeks, to go over some of the background. We talked about the Greeks in the context of the Greco-Persian Wars, and now we need to sort of go back and fill in how they got there.
And that takes us back to...
The Table of Nations?
You are so right. Yeah. Genesis 10. Now, these are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And unto them were sons born after the flood, the sons of Japheth, Gomer, and Magog, and Madai. Those, Madai is the ancestor of the Medes. And Javan, and Tubal, and Meshach, and Tyrus, and so on. And then skipping a verse, and the sons of Javan, Elisha, and Tarshish, Kittim, and Dodanim. And by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, every one after his tongue, after their families, and in their nations. The word here that's rendered Javan, or Yavan, or Ivana, comes across through other directions as Ionia. These are the Greek tribes. The name Elisha may be put an aspirant on it, Hellish, and that might be Halos, who the person the Greeks actually remember as their ancestor.
That phonetic, I don't know what you call that, phonetic drift or something, is so interesting to me. Like, we have Giovanni as the Italian form of John. Yeah. And then, you know, in Ireland, that's Ian or Johan. It's like this, the same letter gets taken away. It's just very interesting to me. And I'm not a linguist. I don't know what that means. But
J's and Y's kind of become interchangeable all across the globe. And at this point, they disappear for the record. But before we leave them there, by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands. The Table of Nations was written fairly early, while Shem, Ham, and Japheth were still alive. So the dispersion had begun, but it hadn't gone all that far. And the nations that are listed there are within a nice compass circles drawing of Mesopotamia, of Ararat, and Shinar, and thereabouts. So all of these peoples in the Table of Nations kept moving, or their descendants kept moving. So this is not a complete picture of the Japhetic peoples. Eventually, they kept moving and got as far as Italy. And most of what we think of as Europe was settled by the descendants of Japheth. Notice, too, that the division, they were divided in their lands, everyone after his tongue, after their families. Now, the story of Babel doesn't come until chapter 11, but the Bible has a lot of flashbacks where it takes us so far and says something, and then says, oh, as we would say, oh, but before we go on, I probably should explain why that, what's going on here. What do you mean
tongues? Kind of like we're doing right now with the Greeks.
Yeah, exactly. It's part of storytelling. Mm-hmm. It starts in Genesis 2, where we run into, what do you mean God said to them? Who's the them? Let me tell you about man and woman, how they, and so Genesis 2 backs up. So we've got here... the announcement in advance that language is a thing, a division in language is a thing. And chapter 11 tells us how that happens. And at the heart of that division was a theological, religious revolt against Yahweh. These people wanted to name themselves, make themselves a city, a community, a tower, a ritual shrine whose top wasn't a heaven. That is a way of reaching deity, of becoming gods themselves, or confronting God and wresting heaven from him. And so what came out of that, aside from a faithful remnant, and it wasn't very big as far as we could tell, were all of these nations. So as we track these, what we would call Greek settlers moving westward to Asia Minor and then across to the Greek mainlands, we need to understand that they are already pagan. Not to say that some might not have maintained some knowledge of the true God, some memories, some stories. I mean, drop into any place in modern America, and you're going to get different memories of this thing called the Bible and this thing called Christianity. In some places, Bible stories and the name God and Jesus are going to strike some deep memories, even among people who don't believe. Other places you drop in and they don't know Jesus except as a curse word. And I remember a young couple that my wife and I ministered to, and we wanted to tell them the Bible story from Genesis to Christ. And I was doing this in 45 minutes. I think it eventually took almost an hour, but we were going along and Noah, flood. They look at me. No, don't. No. Ark. Oh, wait. I just bought this little book from my girl. I think there's that story in there. Got to Samson. Shirley, Samson, long hair, super strength. No, we don't know that. And these were educated, refined people. They had a good income. They're both handsome, wealthy, respectable, college educated. They didn't know the first thing about the Bible. I couldn't imagine such ignorance. And so when we look back through history, archaeology, the ancient writers, it's a mixed bag. And some Christians, in their eagerness to find that common thread, we'll look and say, oh, look here, this is a memory of the Bible. Well, it might well be. It might be something else. Because they did know. They did remember. Noah was their great-grandfather. Japheth was a godly man to a point. But very early, his seed apostatized. So by the time we have any sense of them, we find them building cities as religious institutions around the tombs of their ancestors. But to step back even a little more, because that's what each family did. The pagan world was convinced of a number of things. One, all is one. So divinity is a thing and we're all part of it. Two, creation's impossible, which goes with the other thing. There's no creator God. Man and nature and divinity are all of one substance. And so therefore, they looked for God not so much in the sky above or the sun. They looked first of all in themselves. That's where they expected to find God. Surprisingly enough, they thought they did. And upon death then, each father, grandfather, patriarch was assumed to shed this human coil and go off, and his divinity would shine through. So when you buried granddad, you're giving him a toehold in this world where he can settle down and be comfortable. His heavenly throne isn't heavenly at all. It's in the backyard in a tomb.
Yeah, there's not really a heaven or hell in this system.
No, there's not. The word chthonic comes into play here. It speaks of underground, materialistic, death-oriented kind of gods that you find by going out and digging in the graveyard, but very powerful and frightening gods. As long as you kept them happy, they weren't too bad. They knew their ancestors, looked out for them, would do what they could to bless them. But if you didn't take care of them, nourish them, feed them,
They'd get hangry.
They get angry. They're very cranky. And they might start roaming around. So the stories of ghosts and such. This is not terribly far removed from some Latin American / Roman Catholic ideas of the afterworld. We've all seen Coco, right?
I have not, actually.
You haven't? Oh, you need to see it just so you can go, oh my. It is. I think a cross appears on a wall once in the background, and there may be a passing reference to God or something like that. Everything else is bringing food and flowers and things like that to the dead ancestors to keep them happy. Because if you don't, eventually, well, they get cranky, but eventually they poof out of existence. Because this is a Disney movie and you really don't want to show the answers just coming back and terrorizing you. But it's clear that some ancestors do get neglected, and shame on the descendants who let that happen. And we're given a little peek into a very fantastical version of the other side. But for those who have seen it, for children or teenagers who've seen it, yeah, that's kind of what we're talking about here. The dead ancestors become objects of worship. You need to keep them happy. Also, Agatha Christie's mystery novel, Death Comes as an End, set in Egypt, but it's very, very simple. The whole ancient world was like this. Keep the ancestors happy. Feed the ancestors. Bring wine and bread and such to their tombs as a regular basis. Now, there's no elaborate metaphysical explanation of how the wine that you set on the tomb is transferred across dimensional boundaries to the god, and I don't think anyone worried about it too much. It was just a given that that's how it does that somehow. We can get used to people believing the bread and wine actually become the body and blood of Christ, and you eat God. You know, we can believe anything. So that was family, and some of what went into that is that you're worshiping your own ancestor, your own grandfather, great-grandfather, whatever. And he cares about you, his own bloodline, his own descendants. Doesn't care about anybody else. Not
very
inclined to help them.
Proprietary.
Proprietary is a good word here. Yeah, absolutely. And so you're keeping him happy. He's doing his best to keep you happy. There's no reason in the world anybody else should worship him. And there's no reason in the world he should help anybody else. But the things that he needs have been passed down, father to son, legitimate son, mm-hmm. father to legitimate son to legitimate son. And so some things go with this. Having a father in the household to perform the funerary rites and the worship, both at the tomb and in the hearth fire in the home, it was very important. It was a masculine thing. Ladies were not allowed to do this. It would be passed to a lawful son, normally the firstborn. Bastard sons were right out because they weren't really bloodline, and the great-grandpa would know that and would not tolerate their worship. So that meant that mom was really important if she was faithful. So we honor mom for being a faithful wife. Now, dad can sleep with anyone he wants, as many times as he wants. But mom absolutely needs to be faithful because we have to track a faithful legal bloodline, father to son, to know who has the right to pick up the funerary rites when dad's dead.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that even adoption was acceptable.
Yeah, adoption was
It wasn't necessarily
acceptable.
The bloodline per se, mm-hmm. but it was the legitimacy.
Right. Legitimacy was the thing that was what was really important. Daughters, not so much, because
they're going to go marry and be somewhere else.
Right. Yeah. They're going to get passed on. So we don't really care much about our daughters. We honor mom for bearing faithful sons, but she better be faithful. No messing around, mom. Dad does not have to be monogamous or faithful or anything, as long as he has one faithful line that he has maintained. Also, property. Well, where the tomb is, we have to be there. So that's our land. That's the family land. The hearth fire where we worship and bake our bread and enjoy family living together, that's a god too. And so we need that. So thou shalt not steal means don't take our land, don't take our house. And even the greater claims of the state really couldn't touch that one. Aside from that, ethics were somewhat problematic. Things like love your neighbor. Why? Love your enemy.
Definitely
huh?
Why.
Yeah, definitely. Why would we do that? That doesn't make any sense. They're outsiders. They're the other. They're them. All the nice psychological terms we have these days. But in time, it became clear that families don't do well in isolation. Families would link with families. You get the clans, the gins, as they called them, and then the larger tribes beyond that, and eventually they might settle down into a city, and then you find, and each time when you join with somebody, you find a common ancestor. And by the time you get to cities, you're going way back into mythical times, and you're locating a hero. And hero didn't mean to them what it probably means to us, unless maybe you're talking Marvel and DC. a hero was a son of the gods. He was a divine or semi-divine being who was an ancestor of your family, because, you know, we're all gods. And that being, someone like Theseus or Achilles, some great semi-historical, semi-mythical figure who was himself conceived by a god somehow, they became the person that you built your city around. And the cities were religious institutions. And this is something we've pounded on in the past in other contexts, and we need to keep pounding on it. And Emily, you will now pronounce the name of the author who wrote The Ancient City, because I can never pronounce it.
Foustal de Coulanges.
Ah, very nice. Very nice.
He's fun. It'll be in the show notes if you want to Google it and need the spelling.
Yeah, I never can spell. Not that one. I assume his name is French.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. French. No. Yeah. Rachel, any comments about French spelling? Like, is it a thing?
It actually does have a phonetic alphabet. Yeah, they do actually have a consistent set of how their phonetics work. You just have to actually learn them, and the fact that they are completely different than our style of anything. So
someday you'll have to give me a lesson. I hate coming to French names and knowing I'm butchering the pronunciation, but anyway. The Ancient City, it's a marvelous book that tracks a lot of what we're talking about here, and a lot of the material that I'm presenting comes from there. It is interesting, if not amazing, to see how frankly the author admits the city's religious. The city was always religious. Mm-hmm. It's always built around a god. The hearth fire of the home turns into the altar fire of a temple. And to belong to the city, you must be a worshiper of that god. There's no two ways about it. You don't get to be secular or atheistic or uninvolved. You are committed to the religion of the city by virtue of being in the city. All the outsiders are outsiders. They are aliens, almost in the sense that we use the word in sci-fi. And so if you couldn't find some patriarchal connection, legal or bloodline, that you could trace back, you really couldn't get along with people very well. And even when you could, you didn't always get along with people very well. I think Rachel has pointed out before how well the Greek city-states didn't get along most of the time.
Yes.
When I was in sixth grade, and this shows up in my history syllabus too, I was told that there are five things that united the Greek city-states: common language, common ancestor, Elis, the common religion, but that came later.
Yeah.
The Olympian gods comes much later. That's kind of where we may end up today if we get that far. But the first, it's this ancestor worship coupled with some nature worship. Common shrines, the Oracle of Delphi. It'd be interesting to find out how that one started. Mm-hmm. It is a fascinating phenomena in Earth's history. And there's some questions somebody somewhere knew the answer to once upon a time, but whether we'll ever know them now, I don't know. And so common ancestor and eventually participation in the Olympic Games. But these were all things that drew them together. Common heritage, common descent, and similar family-oriented, patriarchal-oriented religions, and the common language. These were the things that at least allow them to talk to each other and do business with one another, but it didn't guarantee they liked each other very much. Mm-hmm. And more often than not, they got together when they were threatened by some outside force or where there was a good business deal. You know, you can work with just about anything when the money's good. And so to speak of Greece before Alexander is almost like speaking of Italy or Germany before 1850. That didn't exist. Yeah. There were Greek city-states, and these city-states sometimes got along, often competed, often fought each other, occasionally came together in leagues or such. And what they had going for them was more or less a common worldview and this religion that was pulling together. I mentioned a second ago nature worship. It was not uncommon for the ancient world to look up in the sky and see the sun and say, "Wow, that must be a god." when you no longer believe in the God of the Bible, you worship and serve the creature more than the creator. And let's face it, we, although those of us who live indoor most of the time may not notice the sun, the ancient world sure enough did. Mm-hmm. Moon too, and the stars,
very
and the constellations.
Aware of the stars and the moon.
Yeah.
Very
yeah.
important.
Very important. And it helped them track their agriculture and their sailing. So
the, and that's what God put them in the sky for.
Yeah,
for
times oddly and seasons. So these things they adopted, and the fertility of the land, that became very important. But as these cities had their own way of doing things, each one laid hold on these nature gods in different ways. They might give them similar names. I mean, the sun's the sun, right? The moon's the moon. How complicated can this be? Well, I think the moon likes purple. No, she likes red. She. The moon's a he. What? Heretic. So there was a lot of that going on. Of trying.
Even the hobbits and the elves can't agree on that one.
Yeah, there you go. So there, it took time for these city-states to say, all right, we all have a king of the gods, and he's named Zeus. Yeah, Zeus. Yeah, Zeus. Yeah, Zeus. All right, Zeus. Yeah. How about something? No, Zeus. Okay. But what is the, you know, what do you go, where do you go next? Does he have a spouse? A lot of the other cool kids on the block have spouses for their gods. You know, and we start going down the list, and it's interesting that some of the myths that we take as ancient and set in stone, you peek back a little further and they're not exactly so set in stone, and relationships in some of the older versions are not exactly at all what we are used to. And you think, no, somebody got this wrong. No, they were just still working their way toward this. In one of my articles for this, I started with a simple question. Who's your favorite Spider-Man? Ladies, who's your favorite Spider-Man? I'm guessing you have one.
Oh, it's a complicated question, because the fact is, until about 2 years ago, I had loved every single Spider-Man movie that came out. Mm-hmm. All of them.
Yes.
Except for maybe the second Andrew Garfield one, which I think I fell asleep in. But I still loved Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man. But uh-huh. I think probably Tom Holland's is the most actually Spider-Man. And so,
I just like Tom Holland as an actor.
he's great. I enjoy watching his movies.
Rachel, you
have saying, I like Tom Holland's. Or, is it Holland or Hollins?
Holland.
Holland.
Same Thank as you. The historian.
Yes.
Yes.
If that helps.
So I like him as an actor, but I saw the Tobey Maguire ones first, so that's kind of what brought Spider-Man to life. So
They're
there's a certain
special.
Sense of, of, yeah. The first one you see play the part kind of sticks with you the most, but
yeah. And along those lines, the first one I saw, I don't even know the guy's name, was on TV with all of the cheesiness of TV special effects. So it was easy for me to give him up and to actually just weigh the movies one after another. So yeah, Tom Holland, both as Spider-Man and simply as an actor, besides he's got a British accent, so that's cool.
Yeah. But he's also actually a teenager at the time when Peter Parker is supposed to be a teenager.
Yeah, well, that
like
helps.
Tobey Maguire is like, you're like 30, but okay, yeah. You can be in high school. we'll accept that for now.
The reason I ask this is, here's a character that we know a little bit about. Everybody who has watched movies over the last 20 years or so, or 30 years, has knows the character. If you've read comic books, you know him back from forever. Spider-Man, Peter Parker, Mary Jane, J. Jonah Jameson, the Bugle, friendly neighborhood Spider-Man, with great responsibility, or with great power comes great responsibility, you know, all of that and a few other things that everybody could name. And yet, when you get down to talking about the individual character and characteristics as they show up in these movies, everyone's completely different. Mm-hmm. And that's why we can talk about your favorite Spider-Man. Well, the Greeks could talk about, so who's your favorite Athena? Who's your favorite Aphrodite? Who's your favorite Zeus? Well, the one from Athens always seems to work for me. Now, I like the Spartan version. He's a lot cool, you know. It was sort of this, which is a little confusing.
Yeah, we might be missing here the factor of allegiance to a city, because you didn't travel between city and city. you belonged to one. Right. And so there was, you could compare, but you have a loyalty.
You do. There is a loyalty. But to what degree does that manifest? How official are the backstories, I guess? How official are the bios? We agree. Right. We have a Zeus. So do we. Married to Hera? Married to Hera. God of the skies? God of the skies. Loves thunderbolts? Loves thunderbolts.
But you guys are telling stories that we don't have that are pretty
but
cool,
you have,
so we'll take those.
Yeah, we'll borrow some of those stories. Yours are a little cooler than ours. They don't infringe upon our character, our loyalty to our city and its god, because we're all descended from whoever Zeus is. Now, to carry the literary metaphor out a little bit, as we came to the first Avengers movie, we'd already seen Thor and Captain America and Iron Man, Black Widow. I don't think we'd see, well, we hadn't seen Hawkeye yet. In fact, I don't even know if he's ever called Hawkeye for the first few movies. We had seen the Hulk in like three different iterations, none of whom made the cut.
Good. yeah, you don't ask that same question about which is your favorite Hulk.
No. No. So, but we did know, well, some of us who read Marvel Comics, or the Avengers at least, I have a lengthy collection, knew that these characters did live in the same fictional universe, that eventually they teamed up as Avengers, that they had certain relationships, and one or more of the characters tended to be a leader at any given time. But the MCU, the cinematic universe, we didn't know what Hollywood was going to do, because you never know what they're going to do to make a buck. And so we waited, knowing that the Avengers movie was going to tell us the same old story differently. And we hoped we would like it.
Yeah.
That it would be better than all the many potentially really rotten versions they could come up with. There'd be something we could buy into. We could watch a number of movies based around this, but that didn't answer questions. So is Tony or Cap going to be the leader here? Who's going to get along with who? Black Widow, love affair? Yes, no, with whom? These questions weren't settled until we saw the first movie, and somehow the script writers and the actors pulled it off, and we came away saying, okay, those are our Avengers for this decade.
We accept them. Cool.
We accept them. Something like that happened in Greece. Two somebodies in particular, brought all of the various interpretations of the gods together and provided in one book a genealogy and brief history of some of the major details. And in two much longer epic poems, used them as major characters and showed us their relationships, both, do you say biological with with gods? Who was genetic, born from whom?
Perhaps.
Genetic, okay. As well as how they got along or didn't with one another, who liked whom, who was on whose side. And the two authors who did this were a man named Hesiod, who wrote Works and Days, and Theogony. Theogony particularly is relevant here because it's the genealogy of the gods. It takes us all the way back. In the beginning, there was chaos, and out of chaos arose the greater gods. And from these came heaven and earth, and they lay together, and from them came the Titans. And eventually, we get out of the third generation or so, we begin to get the Olympian gods. But Hesiod is tying them up, putting them in a package, and as it were, selling them to the Greek people, saying, here is the new standardized version. And I'm telling it really well with polish and style that you appreciate. You're all buying in, right? And while they're thinking about that, along comes this blind poet named Homer. Unless it was another Homer who was also blind. Yeah, who was the Homer who really wrote the Iliad and the Odyssey? And he writes these two classics, at least supposedly he does, and scholars still argue over that. Let's assume he was a real guy. Yeah. And
scholars still argue about Shakespeare being a person. So
yeah.
You know, might as well just take it.
let's just go with it. Homer cast the gods as background characters in his two great epic poems, the Iliad, which is the story of the Trojan War, and the Odyssey, which is the stories of Odysseus coming home from the Trojan War and taking forever to get home. and for the time and for the culture, these were great works of art. And although I think Christians have fussed over them and oohed and aahed over them far more than they probably deserve, yet there's something to be said for the literary skill and some of the patterns they set. But they are pagan works of literature. And it's one thing to say these are well-told stories about moving, compelling characters, and another to say, and you should imitate them because this is how a young Christian man should live. I'm not kidding. I have an article written by someone involved, a high uppity up in the classical education movement, who basically says the first canon in classical education, the one that teaches young men how to be legitimate young men, is the Iliad. What book are you reading?
I like character. Yeah, are they referencing?
I don't know.
I can't.
I feel
find
like
one.
Spider-Man himself would come before.
Yes,
Achilles.
I would much rather have my children imitate Spider-Man than Achilles. I just, you know, I'd even have them imitate Batman before Achilles. But anyway. Captain America would be much better still. Oh. There's only one God, ma'am, and I'm pretty sure he doesn't dress like that. it's amazing they slipped that one in. So that's what these poets give us. And if we were going to do an extended intro to literature, that would be the next thing. But I don't think we're going to do that. I think we're just going to keep going on. Yeah. We're going to consider the religious significance of this. Because what the poets did, what Hesiod and Homer and others did, was to take the gods and incarnate them, as it were, make them just like us, very relatable, larger than life soap opera characters, superheroes, maybe supervillains, just like us. And there's the rub. You can laugh at these characters, you can stand in awe of them, you can have the dressmaker prints you some kind of little Achilles lives, you know, kind of thing for your shirt. But can you worship these gods? And can you find in them a sufficient basis for ethics and epistemology? And the general response of the next few generations is, no, these are silly characters. These are not worthy of proud humanity. There's got to be something bigger. There's got to be something more. And so Hesiod and Homer, in elevating the gods to the level of some of the greatest literary characters ever, effectively destroyed them as objects of worship and as sources of morality and as cultural cohesive factors. And the Greeks needed something else. So the moment of triumph for the gods was the sunset of their influence as real religious objects of worship and as the focus of a worldview. There might be room for them in your worldview, but not that. And so the Greek philosophers, the pre-Socratics who followed, began to try to wrestle with this. It's not that they rejected deity, that they rejected the idea of God. They just rejected those gods because so would anybody else who had a brain.
They did not conform to the idea of what deity actually should be anymore.
Yeah. They had slid so far from the idea of deity that the philosophers couldn't handle them. And so that's the direction we need to go.
Well, I was going to say, I think one thing we can add, therefore, in making connections in a Christian worldview is that we should keep this in mind as the gospel goes to the Greeks in the New Testament, that for them to bring God down to be like man is to make him not worthy of worship. Mm-hmm. And yet they're going to hear of Jesus Christ who comes as God and yet in no way loses his glory when becoming man, but rather he's going to go all the way to the point of death, which would seem like the least glorious thing possible. And yet in that they actually will be taught that there is the greatest glory. So it's always interesting to see those little brushes in the past where we understand that this is not who God should be. And yet when Jesus comes, in many ways, he defies their expectations as well.
Mm-hmm. To the Jews, a stumbling block, to the Greeks, foolishness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The importance of glory in Greek literature. Oh, like that's yes. a very important word, kleos. Mm-hmm. That mm-hmm. it's all about winning kleos.
Yes.
And so for Jesus Christ to humble himself mm-hmm. is really revolutionary to the Greek mind.
Yeah, it's not the religion they knew. Mm-hmm. And the issue here was not, and we'll talk more about this, I think, probably next time. It's not that they were secularist. Far from it. They were very religious people.
Mm-hmm.
But it was
as
a very
Paul observed.
As Paul observed, in all things you are very religious or very superstitious, depending mm-hmm. on how you want to read the word. Yeah, they and he's talking, and a good point there, because he is talking to Stoics and Epicureans as well as just hangers on. Philosophers. Yeah. Yeah, he's telling them, you are overly religious, overly superstitious, because you've endued everything, every object, with deity. And let me tell you about God who made the world and all things therein, seeing who's not worshipped with man's hands, seeing he's Lord of heaven and earth, and doesn't need anything from his creation. That's, what are these words you are saying, Paul? We understand them individually, but they don't make sense to us.
I've never heard all those words in that order before.
We were just asking about Jesus and Anastasia, and you're talking about creation out of nothing? Okay, that's not the way the world began. We know how the world began. It all began. And so that, I guess, is where we take a step back now. We'll continue this next time, but we can get our foot in the door. What we're seeing then, by the time the poets are done, is we have this very polished, literary, refined sort of religion where the gods are amplified humanity. They are the best and the brightest and the most beautiful, despite the fact that they, well, you know, cheat on one another and rape and pillage and have hot tempers. They're still pretty cool as far as human beings go. And we have the unity of the polis, the city-state that pulls things together, the religious city. And we have the mind of man. And all of these things, we're looking for a unity and a purpose, a epistemological anchor.
Mm-hmm.
But there's that other side. There's Grandpa buried out in the backyard, and I think I hear his bones rattling. There were dark forces, underground forces, dead heroes. And another word that was used for these beings was demon. When the New Testament writers picked up that word and used it for the fallen angels that opposed Jesus, they knew exactly what they were doing.
Yeah, it already had a context.
Yeah.
And that and was they were, these things that the
these
Greeks
things
and
that you're
every
afraid
pagan
of, guess what?
Encountered.
They are enemies of the true God. They're enemies of your souls. And yes, they are only too real. One thing you will stumble across, and this is, I'm more familiar with the Iliad than the other books in the Greek canon. You stumble across Agamemnon, for instance, saying, I didn't start the Trojan War. Why would I do that? That's so unlike me. Well, I would, first of all, beg to differ with him on that one. But he comes across as, it wasn't me, it must have been some god or other. Now, that's a code phrase that appears in Greek literature. Sometimes it's some god, meaning a god whose name they do not know. Or sometimes it's Zeus broadly, meaning the divine, or sometimes a demon. The idea is that there's a divine substructure, chthonic substructure of deity that's constantly bubbling up and comes for a moment and interferes in human life and screws things up for us and then goes away. These are not the eternal deities of Olympus who've escaped all that and live, you know, one set frat party on Olympus all the time. These are coming and going, illogical, things that belong to death and the underworld, and they are dangerous. It's not that they are evil because the Greeks didn't really have that category. But they are frightening. They're uncontrollable. They're unpredictable. They're irrational. That was the word I was looking for earlier. And so what we end up with forming one cohesive worldview is the beautiful, the polished, the ideal, the source of unity for thought and living. And at the same time, this underground bubbling stream of unpredictable, chaotic, divine power. And somehow these things live together because you know what? The people didn't just give up their chthonic gods. They didn't give up on Grandpa simply because a new Avengers movie came out. So not just because Homer wrote the Iliad and the Odyssey. That did not compel everybody to go and turn Grandpa's grave into a trash dump or something. They continued on with the old religions. And so there's this constant tug back and forth in Greek culture. Aristotle will use the words form and matter to try to show that he's well aware that there are these two principles and that philosophy somehow must take them into account. Mm-hmm. And although matter is the lesser of the two, there's no notion that this is the divine versus the non-divine. It's just various flavors of divine, of divinity, struggling with one another, trying to find some kind of dialectical unity that people can work with and live with. And that becomes the job of the post-Socratics. Once Socrates is gone, Plato and Aristotle have to struggle with this, and then the Hellenic philosophers have to struggle with this and try to find some way to pull this all together. And what modern philosophy and historians have got wrong is they didn't jettison religion to do it. Mm-hmm. They continued to cling to very religious basic principles and tried to make that the foundation of a new world order, a new worldview, and they simply failed. So that by the time Jesus comes on the scene, Pilate can look him in the eye and say, "What is truth?" He was speaking as a man of his time. He understood enough to know that Greece had no answers. The philosophers had no answers. And to send young Christian students back to read the philosophers and hope that they will obtain some sort of insights into life is not only sheer nonsense, it is ridiculously dangerous. Mm-hmm. And that will become clear, I think, as we go along.
Yeah. Not that you shouldn't read dangerous things. But you should realize Depends. They're dangerous. Yes. You should use a sharp knife in the kitchen, not on your fingers. Yeah.
But you don't hand it to your three-year-old and turn your back to go fix supper.
Well, and I think something that'll be interesting to talk about later is the connection then that we can see in the thought of the Roman Catholic Church and of the Greeks, since they are a lot of the ones that started this in European thought. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking back to your connection to Coco and such, and the ways that we see a lot of merging and blending of these older pagan ideas into the Roman Catholic system in various forms, where Roman Catholicism does look different in the different parts of the world that it goes to.
It's very adaptable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It has the ability to, as you say, to blend, to assimilate without actually altering itself, because at root they've adopted some basic concepts and basic presuppositions that are not biblical. But it's not always easy to see that, especially if you live in America and you know the Roman Catholic priest who ministers down the block. He may actually believe the Bible. Yeah. But you need to peel back and look at the system that's been there for a very long time and see what the system says and what it allows, and you begin to get an idea of why it is adaptable. But as you say, that's for later.
For another time. For now, shall we rack up some additional recommendations is what we can rack up. I actually have one.
Good.
Since we were talking about some god or other and the fates. We didn't quite talk very much about the fates, but I've recommended this before, but it's a Anglo-Saxon piece called The Heliand, colloquially called colloquially called the Saxon Gospel. It's a retelling of the four Gospels as monks were ministering to the barbarians after the sack of Rome. And one of the themes that you can trace through it is starting off with this presupposition of, oh, well, even the gods can't get around the fates. There are some things that are just the way they are, and there's no two ways about it. And so it kind of starts off with, yeah, the fates said it was time for Jesus to be born, things like that. And then gradually it turns and says, oh, did the fates didn't intend that. And so it's kind of interesting. It's, it's, you know, definitely not the inspired word of God. but as a literary interaction with the gospel and with the pagan mindset, it's a really fascinating work. It is a little bit disappointing at the end because the manuscripts are incomplete. So you get to the end and it's like, and we don't have any more. Like, oh, I was really hoping for, like, you know, climax and denouement, but we didn't, we don't get that. But it's called The Heliand. It's a little hard to find, but you can find it on Amazon.
Yeah. Okay. Rachel, you got anything?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize you were talking to me. Yes, mine is very different. Recently in one of his sermons, my husband David mentioned a modern hymn that has become one of my favorites. I was actually first introduced to it in Cornerstone Chapel. And that one is called Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me, by originally by City of Light. And whenever I read through the lyrics, it is very encouraging, particularly thinking of the pagan Greek religions and other religions that are constantly in the doing, doing, doing. You can never stop. You always have to keep pacifying, and you never know what the fates are going to do. This song is very much an encapsulation of the finished work of Christ and the complete peace and joy that we can have in lots of different situations. So if you have never heard it, I recommend finding it. I believe the Gettys also sing it and others.
Cool, cool.
This at first seems not terribly relevant to anything, but I think it is. Two books by Don Richardson. I know you both know Peace Child. Mm-hmm. He also wrote Eternity in Their Hearts, which is a taking the idea of Peace Child. For those of you who don't know Peace Child, I'm not going to tell the whole story, but it amounts to God has allowed memories, either direct memories or shattered, twisted memories of spiritual truth of the gospel, to survive in the remote corners of the earth in pagan lands. And the classic example here is Paul on Mars Hill saying, the unknown God, I'm going to tell you about him. And he's not cheating. There's actual historical facts behind that that say, yes, it was the God of the Bible who intervened in Greek history. And Paul is using that to point back. Similarly, in China, early missionaries had trouble communicating the gospel in China because they were presenting Christianity as an alien religion, a religion of white men. But then somebody discovered that the very Chinese characters reflected a memory of something much more ancient. For instance, the word for ship was a boat with eight people on it. the word for righteousness was I standing under the Lamb. You know, some of these things, and the missionaries began to pick up on this and say, oh, yeah, we're not telling you a new religion. We're telling you your old religion.
Yeah. The pictures we draw are important.
It made a difference. And anyway, Peace Child is about one particular incident or case study in what was the Netherlands, New Guinea. It's Papua New Guinea now, I guess.
Irian Jaya.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then the other, Eternity in Their Hearts, is more of a looking around at other cultures and things, much briefer stories. But I think my point here is, as we look at the ancient world, certain themes do reoccur as people tried to invent their own religions. Surprisingly enough, man's not all that creative. he really doesn't, there's nothing new under the sun, and he keeps coming up with very similar ideas. And some of them are probably memories of scripture. Now, we need to be careful with this. but there have been times when the coincidences are so high, and sometimes they're not coincidences. There's a story of, I don't remember where it's set, and this is, I think, from Eternity in Their Hearts. A missionary, white man, goes to a remote Indian village and spends a lot of time learning that dialect, because, of course, India has a ton of them. And when he thinks he knows enough to carry on an intelligent conversation, he goes to the marketplace, where there's a lot of people coming and going, a lot of old people just sitting there talking. And he holds up the Bible and says, I bring to you words of life from God. He holds up the Bible. Most people ignore him. But a few of the older sorts say, what did he just say? He said words. That's why I know it. Get him over here. And they call him over and say, what? We can't help noticing that you are a white man. You know, sorry, but yeah, I am. And you're holding a book. Yes, I am. And it is words of life. Yes, they are. From God. That is correct. Do you know where we come from? Well, here. Originally. No. There was a time when our fathers built a ladder to heaven.
Oh, you remember that, do you?
And God overthrew it. And we wandered south and east and came to mountains. And we could not cross them, and there was no place for us to go. And so the demons of the mountains cut us a deal. They would let us through if we would worship them. Mm. And we have worshiped them ever since. But somewhere in our past, someone told us that one day a white man would come with words of life in a book. And when he came, we should listen and we would be freed from worshiping the demons.
Mm. Wow.
Okay.
Sometimes God does not work in mysterious ways. Sometimes yes. They're very obvious.
Yeah. Well, once you realize that the history of the world is exactly what the Bible says, and we've only got 4,000 years to play with, and most of it on this side is, you know, a lot less than that, we should expect these kind of things. But no, we think of the Bible as myth and poetry, and or these things happened a long time ago in Bible land, these Bible stories, Bible times, and Bible people, rather than realizing they're not that far back and that some people actually do have memories. So anyway, Peace Child and Eternity in Their Hearts, Don Richardson's the author.
Yeah, that puts me in mind of how Cornelius Van Til would talk about the point of contact.
Yeah.
Where we talk a lot about the antithesis, where the pagan mind is in all ways opposed to God. Mm-hmm. And yet there are still places to communicate.
God has not left himself without witness.
Yeah. Right. There's always a way to communicate, even though you're opposed on every point until God changes their hearts. Mm-hmm.
Until God changes your heart by the gospel.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you both so much for this conversation. It's been a delight. And thanks also to David, our producer, and my lawfully wedded husband. I'd like to give a special shout out to one of our most faithful listeners, Trish, who has not only listened to, I'm pretty sure, every episode, she has started listening back through in this most recent series. She's like, I got up to date, and then I just like started the series two over again. So thank you, especially Trish, for listening. Oh, I'm so glad that we're saying things that are in some way helpful or encouraging or something to you, something to keep you listening.
I still run into random people I barely know say, I was listening to your podcast and I have a question. How do you even know about it? So whoever you are that's sharing this with people, go on and keep sharing and keep telling people. There's got to be people out there who would like to hear these things. Mm-hmm. Not everybody for sure, but
yeah. We're niche, but we know that.
We're niche. That's better than saying elite or elect, I guess. So niche is good.
All right. Yes. Thank you to everyone who's shared our podcast, as well as to everyone who's ever listened. Big thank you also to our financial supporters for keeping the show rolling. If you'd like to join their number, you can visit our Patreon. That's patreon.com/haltingtowardszion. The Anchor support link that we used to use, I think it still works. They just haven't really treated our supporters very well in the past. They've made it kind of difficult for them to support us in the way that works best for them. So Patreon is kind of the preferred option there. And you can follow us wherever you get your podcasts. We're on Spotify, Google Play. I can't keep track of iTunes, Google Play, whatever Apple and Google are doing, we're there. Please leave us a 5-star review. If you think we're worth 5 stars, if you don't, then just don't leave us a review. That's. But if you want to get in touch with us, email is the best way to do that. You can reach us at haltingtowardszion@gmail.com. Thank you so much for listening. We'll see you next time. Bye.